American Beauty kind of has grabbed both the public's attention, but also the hard-bitten critics are saying, best thing to happen in 20 years.
The fact that this movie has turned out to be as cinematic as it was, to have been embraced as it has, bodes well for the industry. Maybe they'll make more movies like it if it does make money.
For the movie to be good and for people to like it, it's just so wonderful.
Life is so fast and hectic and filled with distraction. You have to sort of teach yourself to be still and be quiet and allow yourself to look for what I call beauty.
It's the weirdest thing. I feel like I've been in a coma for about 20 years, and I'm just now waking up.
I started writing it as a play several years ago, but the idea always rattled around in my brain.
My name is Lester Burnham. I'm 42 years old. In less than a year, I'll be dead. Of course, I don't know that yet. And in a way, I'm dead already.
The movie is about how we have preconceived notions about things, and then there's usually a lot more going on.
That's my wife, Carolyn, and my daughter, Jane.
It was the best screenplay that either one of us had ever read. It was so incredibly funny on one hand, yet also quite moving on the other hand.
The script came in to us, and Dan and I looked at each other and we said, you know, wow, I wonder if there will be studios out there who would be brave enough to buy the script. Our hypothesis was that if there was a studio that would want to make this movie, it would be DreamWorks.
When Spielberg had come out and stopped and talked with us on that first day, he said, the script's great, make it right away, don't change a thing. We were gonna need a director who would attract great actors and would be the ultimate actor's director. It really felt like all roads were pointing to Sam.
It was unlike anything I'd ever read before, and you can't say that about many scripts, and we can't say that about much writing at all.
Jane, honey, are you trying to look unattractive?
Yes.
Congratulations, you've succeeded admirably. Lester, could you make me a little later, please? Because I'm not quite late enough.
Yes, thank you.
When Sam came on as director and I met with him, he said, well, you know, who do you see in these roles? And I went, I don't know. And he said, well, my first choices are Kevin Spacey and Annette Bening. And I kind of went, okay, yeah, they're good, get them.
When I read the script, I immediately felt that I was on familiar ground, and everything that was happening was familiar to me.
My husband, Lester.
It's a pleasure.
Oh, we've met before, actually. This thing last year, or the thing Christmas at the Sheridan.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's okay. I wouldn't remember me either. I was struck by how real it felt in terms of the way it depicted the relationship. Because it was honest, that was one of the reasons why it was so funny.
Hi.
Remember Angela?
Yes, of course.
I forgot to tell you, she's gonna spend the night. Is that okay?
It's very funny. It's also one of those scripts where you can see a little bit of a lot of people that you know in it, a lot of family people that you know, possibly in your own family.
Mom, do we always have to listen to this elevator music?
No. No, we don't. And as soon as you've prepared a nutritious yet savory meal that I'm about to eat, you can listen to whatever you like.
It touches on very controversial issues, but oddly enough, I don't think it's very far removed from what happens in suburbia.
So, Janie, how was school?
It was okay.
Just okay?
No, Dad. It was spectacular.
It's as odd and quirky as life is. I mean, all you have to do is read the paper and see how odd life is in America.
Well, you want to know how things went at my job today? They've hired this efficiency expert, this really friendly guy named Brad. How perfect is that? And he's basically there to make it seem like they're justified in firing somebody because they couldn't just come right out and say that, could they? No, no, that would just be too honest. And so they've asked us, you couldn't possibly care less, could you?
Well, what do you expect? You can't all of a sudden be my best friend just because you had a bad day. I mean, hello. You've barely even spoken to me for months.
I think the movie is about people who are searching for meaning in their lives. And we're all doing that every day, but rarely do you see a movie about that.
The script was very, very compelling. And when Sam got hold of it, though, he took it to a whole other level because Sam became very involved in the further realization of Alan Ball's, dream.
Call me irresponsible.
I marvel that you can be so contemptuous of me on the same day that you lose your job.
Listen, I didn't lose it. It's not like, whoops, where'd my job go? I quit. Someone passed the asparagus.
Oh, don't give a second thought as to who's going to pay the mortgage. We'll just leave it all up to Carolyn. You mean you're going to take care of everything now, Carolyn? Yes, I don't mind. I really don't. You mean everything? You don't mind having the sole responsibility? Your husband feels he can just quit his job and you don't...
Will someone who's please gonna pay the pass me now? The asparagus?
I'm not going to be a part of this.
Shut up!
Call me irresponsible. Yes, I'm unreliable, but it's undeniably true.
I am sick and tired of being treated like I don't exist. You two do whatever you want to do, whenever you want to do it, and I don't complain. All I want
is
the
same... Oh, you don't complain? Oh, please, excuse me. I must be psychotic, then. If you don't complain, what is this? Yeah, let's bring in the laugh meter and see how loud it gets on that one. You don't complain.
We had 2 weeks rehearsal, which for many is a luxury now. And I thought was a necessity, but, you know, I would coming from the theater.
It's a very bonding experience for everyone. We all got to know each other and everybody sort of becomes a family.
We hear now from the cast that they all look back on that 2 week rehearsal period as the time where the movie sort of was hatched.
At least I didn't fake it, I hacked, so what, I didn't make it.
It was just a great sense of standing on the same side of the fence, looking in the same direction.
You guys can lean back in the rows, you can lean forward in the rows, do whatever you would normally do, okay?
Well, don't do that.
It has been really a joyful experience, just because of everyone involved, and everyone's doing it because they love the script.
Smile, you're at Mr. Smiley's.
Would you like to try our new beef and cheese pot pie on a stick? Just $1.99 for a limited time only?
We were just at a seminar. Buddy, this is my...
Her husband. We've met before, but something tells me you're going to remember me this time.
Something happens to Lester that perhaps makes him realize the lack of honesty in his life, the lack of communication, the lack of being able to say what he actually feels and do what he actually wants.
Would you like smiley sauce with that?
Lester, just stop it!
No, no. You don't get to tell me what to do ever again.
Lester rediscovers the ability to amuse himself and to find those things in life that are worth laughing at.
What?
Whose car is that out front?
Mine. 1970 Pontiac Firebird, the car I've always wanted, and now I have it. I rule!
He begins to change dramatically, as does Carolyn, and the whole family turns upside down.
Lester, you're gonna spill beer on the couch.
So what? It's just a couch.
This is a $4,000 sofa, upholstered in Italian silk. This is not just a couch.
When Annette gets into her character, there is absolutely no stopping her.
Oh, I see you're smoking pot now. I'm so glad.
I think using illegal psychotropic substances is a very positive example to set for our daughter.
I'm a little worried about Annette. She's definitely become possessed by Caroline. You can see that whenever we sort of let the camera roll and we improv.
I don't understand how you get him to flourish like this.
Well, I'll tell you, eggshells and Miracle-Gro.
She's quite miraculous. And in fact, we are having so much fun that it's probably illegal.
You know James Whitmore?
Yes.
I'm related to him.
The three young performers who just so easily shared scenes with Kevin and Annette and Chris Cooper is something that you don't often see.
What are you doing?
I was filming this dead bird.
Why?
Because it's beautiful.
He uses the camera to remember things. It's not that that's his eye, but when you look through a camera and a camera can zoom so tight, he gets to see something that maybe we all miss.
Look, I want you to stop filming me.
Okay.
Jane is a girl who has the ability to appear very normal, but as the story moves along, you become to realize that she is quite unique.
Do you need a ride? Are you crazy? I don't want to end up hacked to pieces in a dumpster somewhere.
It's okay, I'll walk.
Angela is a very flamboyant, dramatic individual who is kind of a lost individual in a way, too.
I think I'm gonna walk, too. What? Jane, that's like almost a mile.
All right, here we go. Ready, and background action. Very good. Action.
The movie stands or falls on the performances, you know, but there is nevertheless a very distinctive visual style, which I'm trying to give the film in tandem with Conrad Hall, who's the fantastic cinematographer.
Maybe we should shoot this at 30 frames, huh? Wouldn't that be nice? Sexy.
That's full spot, flooding out.
When I found out Thomas Newman would be scoring the movie, I was very happy. I love Thomas's score. It's very contemporary. It's not traditional movie music. It's kind of amused, but brooding at the same time.
I was hoping you'd give me a bath. Very, very dirty.
And then there are specific moments where it does become just really incredibly gentle and still. The music that plays when you first see Ricky filming Jane and Lester through the kitchen window, it's just so haunting.
Sam went off and made one of the most auspicious debuts I've ever seen in my career of helping young filmmakers get their start. I've never really seen anything as remarkable as Sam's debut.
American Beauty marks the directorial debut of award-winning theater director Sam Mendes. In bringing this funny and moving film about life in suburban America to the screen, the British director looked to classic American films, such as the award-winning Sunset Boulevard, The Apartment, and Ordinary People for inspiration.
I still count as the best moment of the whole process, the moment that I first showed it to Stephen. And, you know, he likes to watch movies alone, so I was pacing up and down the corridor, you know. And finally I got word, you know, Stephen's finished the movie, and I went in and he stood up and he had tears in his eyes and he said, "You've made a classic movie."
What Sam brought to this movie was talent and a tremendous, tremendous insight into the human condition.
A couple of things led us to Sam Mendes. We went to see his production of Cabaret in New York, and it was so unique and distinctive and exciting. And he directed this play, this musical, like it was a movie.
In theater, the process is an organic process. The play emerges gradually out of the mist. In film, you work on tiny pieces at a time, and your job as the director is to polish each tiny piece whilst keeping the whole in your head.
And now, for your halftime entertainment, Rockwell High's award-winning dancing Spartanette.
I could tell by the way Sam Mendes did it that he'd done a lot of plays, because that's how you do it when you do a play. Everybody sort of becomes a family.
With a director like Sam Mendes, whose emphasis in the theater is so conducive to my own and certainly to Annette's upbringing as well, that the opportunity that we've had to rehearse on this set has been a great deal of fun.
I'm just amazed at the skill and the talent that all of these people brought to the process of making my script, and I'm so incredibly grateful and feel so lucky that it happened.
It wasn't really the film I expected. I didn't expect as much raw truth, and I also didn't expect as much humor.
It's a story about what do we dream for, and what do we hope for, and what do we fight for.
It was one of those days where it's a minute away from snowing, and this bag was just dancing with me. That's the day I realized that there was this entire life behind things.
Beauty is in the strangest places, a piece of garbage floating in the wind. And that beauty exists here in America. It exists everywhere. You have to develop an eye for it and be able to see it.
Very often it takes some kind of event to stir up your life to realize that what you have, you know, is really enough.
Sometimes there is so much beauty in the world. I feel like I can't take it.
And then I remember to relax and stop trying to hold on to it. And then I can't feel anything but gratitude for every single moment of my stupid little life. You have no idea what I'm talking about, I'm sure. But don't worry. You will someday.
Well, did you have any idea that the kind of buzz around this movie was going to happen as you were writing it?
No, absolutely not. If I had, I think I would have freaked out and not finished it.
So glad I did it. I think it's a really beautiful movie.
What's happening right now with American Beauty is absolutely thrilling. It's incredible, the response that the movie has received from critics, from audiences around the world.
This has been viewed as the most auspicious debut of a director since Mike Nichols did Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. Some movies you wear like a tattoo. I just knew when I saw this picture that Sam had made a movie that I was not going to be able to rub off with soap and water.
When I saw this, I was so knocked out.
I fell in love with it the first time I read it, and I knew I had to do it.